I love when people say, well, back in my day, this thing was better, okay? And then the way that it is now, because that's always a really good way to start an argument. They completely ignore the pains, issues, and ultimately the reality of whatever it is that they're referencing, because people only remember the good old days. But hey, it's still nice to look back and remember the good times, then never the bad, right? I mean, it's just how we kind of go about it. And that's not being mean, that's just ignorant bliss. It's kind of like RuneScape. I loved it, but if I had to grind anymore for fletching longbows anymore, I would probably argue that the game just really isn't that fun. But I remember making PK music videos, and that was the blast, okay? I'm Alex, Alex at FI on Instagram, and today's second ever episode of What Happened, it's a new series. We got a new intro, new energy, and kind of sort of the same in mentality with how we go into talking about the subject, but with engines. More specifically, this is What Happened to, why do we love the famous, the iconic, the definitely known difficult motor of the rotary engine, and just why it actually died. What hasn't died though, my commitment to saying wheels, tires, and suspension being available over at fitmentindustries.com, because damn it, that's how we keep the lights on and that's how we keep Trey paid, okay? And Dakota's Taco Bell satisfaction satisfied. We all have our own in-house brand, Artisa ArtFormed wheels, where you can get those things mounted with tires, shipped to your door for free, and of course, we also have quick delivery now on some of our in-stock product, which means you can get it in as little as 7 days, which is actually pretty freaking neat when you consider the fact that the world is actually ending and you can't even find wheat bread right now. If anybody knows me, they know how difficult it is to find wheat bread. They know how much I love wheat bread, and it just really upsets me that I can't find wheat bread. How does that affect the supply chain? I just don't understand. The rotary engine is an iconic engine, and if you don't know what it is, let me help you. All the way back in the early 1950s, there's a man by the name of Felix Heinrich Wankel, all right? Now, Wankel was a mechanical engineer that had been tasked with trying to find a new way to develop a combustionable power that was unlike the existing internal combustion motors that were already out there at the time, eventually just kind of citing some of the weaknesses that the ICs had. So, Wankel would then go out for some time, like a serious amount of time, to making an engine that was better, that was faster, that was lighter, and that was simpler than some of those garbage standard motors at the time. Not only that, but the ultimate goal was to be able to create a platform that allowed smooth power with minimal vibrations, unlike a piston engine. Something that had a nice power curve, something that just worked well. And he did it. In 1954, Felix would develop the rotary engine, with the help of a few friends. The Wankel rotary engine, dubbed the DKM-54, was up and operational. And although it did a good job, it was more of like a prototype than it was something you could actually just slap into a car. It was kind of punky and big and heavy and wide and just unconventional. It took a few years and a man by the name of Hans Dieter Paschke in 1956, who made it cheaper and easier to produce into mass quantities. Now, I probably said his name wrong, but at this point, you guys are just along for the ride and you know that I'm gonna say it wrong. I'm trying. And I'm sorry. And by all technical terms, it was Goliath to the piston engine, and everyone wanted it. When I say everyone, I mean every manufacturer wanted this motor. More than 100 companies would rush to license the rotary engine, and hopes were high. But just like electrical cars in 2001, everyone liked the idea, but not enough to do it because it just wasn't good enough to be a reliable and consistent motor at the time, mostly just because it was too far ahead of its time. Except there was one company that really just didn't want to give up, and that company would be the one that you know, and I know, the one that we love called Mazda. Mazda would start selling rotary powered cars, starting with the Cosmo Sport in 1967, and even while Suzuki, Norton, and even almost Chevrolet with their Corvette would see rotary power plants either almost get that actual beautiful little engine bay together, or it was sold for a very short period of time. You could actually see rotary engines in non-Mazda platforms in the early 60s and late 70s. But nearly everyone couldn't sustain the platform outside of Mazda, and Mazda would try to continue and refine the rotary engine, making its way into the most iconic cars like the JDM cars out there, like the RX-7. And while the coffin was pretty well established for its death in the late 90s, Mazda would continue to try and keep it alive as one of the sole manufacturers to produce this incredibly interesting motor. I mean, it really was kind of fun, and it was a really interesting design. It was mechanically a very cool thing to do. The 13B rotary with 1.3 liters produced 232 horsepower, 178 horsepower per liter. It was more addicting than sports car manufacturers trying to make this engine work, because a comparable output, like something like an LS2 with that sort of horsepower per liter, would put it at 1100 horsepower at the same amount of liters. That's a lot of Coca-Cola bottles, and that was something that was really sick. And while we all love the Mazda RX-8, the most recent iteration of the RX, we were also quickly to disavow it for its unreliability, lack of high-end power comparable to others at the same price, and the fact that it really, really, really loved triangles. I remember watching regular car reviews when I was a little bit younger and watching them review the RX-8 and literally seeing how many triangles they put on that car. Now, the rotary engine is dead, so why? Why is a motor that, when talked about, is treated as one of the best, strongest, fastest, best-sounding lawnmowers ever in the car scene? Why? What immediately plagued the Wankel rotary was its design. Now, while it was small, lightweight, and high on horsepower per liter, it came at an incredibly high burn rate in almost every part of its design. Its design simultaneously deals with heating and cooling in vastly different parts of its assembly, but it all occurs in the same housing. This is one of the key pieces that starts to wane on the design. The heat transfer, as way more eloquently designed by Engineering Explained, he got whiteboards and fancy things, and he's got a nice smile that just makes you trust him. Is that the top of the housing is cool, while the bottom of the housing is much hotter. The seals essentially have difficulty mating to this, especially with it being a metal-to-metal, as it one expands faster than the other. This can cause warping and issues to occur. Now, you can use things like cooling jackets and other modifications, which have been used in mass production in the past and in the aftermarket scene as well, but it only minimized the problem. It doesn't inherently totally remove it. That sealing always was tough, but the motor wanted to make insane power, and that was something that it did extremely well for how small it actually was, which is why it's another reason that it probably died. The rotary is a powerful engine, and one of some of the most craziest, coolest builds have this sort of motor under the hood. And you've seen people like Mad Mike, Rob Dom, Rob, my hero, coming back, beautiful. Hoonigan, Hurt, and more all run them, and the community is infatuated with the thought of them because they do some incredible stuff. But it's kind of like the DeLorean for car collectors. They are so awesome, but if you don't have someone managing the car itself and its maintenance, it's just not gonna be easy to work with. DeLoreans are terrible to own as a collector, and that's why a lot of people hire collectors specifically to maintain the DeLorean. Now, the motors require warm-up. Additional oil consumption can become tedious, and the occasional rebuilds that exist most predominantly for the RX-8 and the RX-7 become ignored like a dentist appointment because owners just don't want to do it anymore. And that just feeds into the culture of them being unreliable. And normal enthusiasts really don't want to deal with some of the quirks and features that would make Doug DeMuro moist when it comes to things like the rotary engine and everything that comes along with it. Which is why the environmentalists and EPA also they weren't fans of the engine. They just never really have been, because the platform wasn't really good for gas mileage. The emissions weren't great at its launch, and they never really even got that much better to crawl out of the hole that it dug itself in, especially when you consider the 70s when the EPA was really getting into it. It backfired constantly and got incredibly hot. For 200 horsepower and 16 miles per actual gallon, it made it relatively expensive to own. And when the RX-8 came out back in the late 2000s, and when in 2008 when gas prices were over $5 a gallon, it's further just kind of killed it. And only the OGs remember when gas was like $5.30 a gallon. That was terrible. The reason the rotary engine officially died in the mainstream market is because it's not a mainstream engine. The Wankel rotary engine, for all intensive purposes, was like an off-meta build. It was like a mid-champ in bot lane, okay? And it just wasn't really meant to be there. And it required additional maintenance. It had lower reliability, and it couldn't be really mass-produced, or it could scale the power to align with some of the competition in some of the most recent years. But it is a f***ing rotary, and they're one of the coolest things ever. And it's like an RX-7 for life. You can't get out of it once you're in it. It's like being an air-cooled enthusiast. You just hate water-cooled because they exist. The rotary Wankel can be an incredible platform with incredible performance, and it has a really good balanced power curve. It has some insane RPM, and my God, the sound of the RX-7 is like something that makes you excited as a Sears catalog when you're 10 years old. I mean, my God, they sound so good. And while the Wankel rotary may not be alive anymore, its success lives on like its air-cooled engine counterpart by those that can manage some of its shortcomings while maximizing its potential, because they deserve it. Because at the end of the day, if you can put up with it and you do know how to work around it, it's a great platform. But yeah, It's doubtful to come back with the pizzazz that it had in the 90s, but that's okay. It's just like the memories of RuneScape, likely to stay an actual memory versus remembering the amount of grinding required to get to 91 runecrafting and running into Edgeville praying that you don't get smited. What do you think? Should the Rotary engine ever come back, or is it something that should just kind of stay in the rear view mirror, maybe in the record books and never ever come back? Let us know below, and of course, drop a comment on what you'd like to see us talk about next in our next episode of What Happened. And if you're looking for wheels, tires, or suspension, be sure to check us out over at fitmentindustries.com. Special thanks to those on Instagram that picked this out for me. It truly means a lot, and I hope to keep making more videos like this. We will see you later. Peace.